Welcome to the show, From the Soapbox to the Stage. I'm your host, Bill Corbett. I'd like to welcome my newest viewers watching this show on the Community Access Channel out of Aurora, Colorado. Their viewers join the thousands now watching the show on public access television across the country. If you've ever dreamed of standing on a stage to inspire, educate, or motivate an audience, then stay tuned. I'll be interviewing top speakers and sharing tips on each episode for helping aspiring speakers, as well as those who have already stepped onto a stage, how to move from public speaker to professional speaker. Now, many professionals speak as part of their business marketing plan, but how many of those actually get invited back to do it again? Only those with the talent and professional business skills that meeting planners and event organizers are really looking for. That's what viewers will learn here as they hear from professional speakers who have been there and done that. With me on the show today is National Speakers Association Hall of Fame speaker, Alan Parisse. He was named one of the top 21 speakers for the 21st century by Successful Meetings magazine and has been quoted in numerous business publications, including The Wall Street Journal, Business Week, and Barron's. Mr. Parisse's successful journey is an interesting one, rising up from garbage collector to Wall Street executive. Welcome to the show, Alan.
Hi.
So, interesting journey, garbage collector to executive. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I was a garbage collector with a college degree, so let's be clear about that.
Okay.
In New Jersey. And that was all of like about 8 months of my life, but it was a good 8 months. I enjoyed that. And then gradually I went back to school, got a master's degree, and then ended up working in financial services, first in San Francisco and eventually on Wall Street.
So what do you do today? Tell us about exactly what your role is, what your job is, what you do now.
Well, two things. One is on the speaking side. The other is coaching and coaching speakers. On the speaking side, I work on everything starts with the core of change, although you don't use the word much anymore. It's been heard too much. But that leadership has changed. Sales has changed. And also, I speak a lot in financial services and the way advisors interact with their clients. That's changed too. With the internet and everything else going on, there's a lot of change. What makes up a leader today is not what made a leader when I was growing up and on the garbage truck 30 years ago. Nowadays, it's a very different environment.
In what way?
Well, in terms of leadership, a lot of the sources of power to a leader and influence to a leader are all either gone or diminished. It used to be that the leader had all the information in the organization, if you think a big organization. Everything fed up to the leader, and the leader doled it out as he or she saw fit. Nowadays, anybody with an access code or a 13-year-old in the house can have almost all the information. Look what just happened recently, J.P. Morgan. They know where I live. I have an account there. Nowadays, anybody can get the information or close enough to anybody. And that's a source of enormous source of power that's not there. What's going to replace it becomes the question. And some of the other things along the same line. It isn't even that long ago that physical ability was a lot of what a leader had. If you mess up at the Ford plant, they take you outside and show you who is boss. Don't do that anymore. Where's the leadership going to come from? And it comes from things like coaching and things like mentoring and a lot of other things. And that's what we get into.
So how is this transition must have changed leadership in a lot of large organizations as far as them taking leadership or demonstrating leadership, do you think?
It's changing it, but it's very much a work in progress.
Yeah.
If you go to some of the newer companies, some of the technology firms, it's a whole different thing, and you see some of where it's going to end up. But when you get into some of the traditional older firms, they're working on it, and it's still a change in process.
Can you specifically pinpoint in your career where you transitioned to become a speaker?
Oh, yeah.
Can you tell us about it?
Oh, easily. First, two answers. One, it was gradual. More and more, when I had real jobs, I was the company spokesperson. And I would go out in the financial world and I would speak to their various publics. The investing public, the advising public, and even some of the deal-making public. And I would speak to them, and that's how I cut my teeth in it. And then the part of the investment business that I was in was effectively legislated out of existence around 1988. And all of a sudden it was gone. I mean, the joke became, it wasn't funny at the time, but the joke became that my resume went from 2.5 pages to my name and address. and the address was in serious jeopardy. I mean, so it was a very tough time. But I then occurred to me, you know, I really enjoyed speaking. Let's see if I can make a living just speaking. And I got on the phone and I called people and I said, last year you had me with a bias. The first call I made, last year you had me with a bias for free. How about you pay me $1,500 and I'll come out and speak? The guy said yes. So the next person I called, it was $2,000. And $2,500, I started to get resistance. Stayed there for a year. And that's how I built my business. That was the beginning of my business. And then I started working with speakers bureaus, which takes a long time to break in. But when those agents start to like you and know you show up and know you do a good job for their clients, it keeps the calendar going along.
So it sounds like you use the market to determine what your fee would be?
Yes.
What people were willing to pay?
Yeah, where I got resistance is where I stopped and then stayed there a while and then bumped it up. And then you start getting to know the business and what other people are doing and measure fee that way.
As a speaker, did you get on the phone and do the work yourself, or did you have an assistant to help you do that in the beginning?
Yes.
You did it all yourself?
No, I did it myself and I had an assistant.
Oh, okay.
I did both. I did it myself, and the assistant started going after the speakers bureaus as her primary focus. And that took a long time, but gradually that started to happen.
So you brought a piece of footage with you, and we're going to roll it now because I think it's a great example of what you do on stage. And this was for what organization? Do you remember?
The Million Dollar Roundtable.
The Million Dollar Roundtable. Okay.
Yes.
Let's take a look at that clip right now.
Please welcome Alan Parisse.
That's a little better. You know, for years they've been telling us to think outside the box. We've got a few minutes to think on top of the thing. We have to, because this world keeps changing and people need your advice. Anybody in this room, two things. At some point in your life, you had a dream of getting a recreational boat. And two, you actually got a boat. Put your hand up, hold them up a second. Come on, let's see them. Now, did the dream include cleaning that thing? How about spending money on it? Was that part of the dream? So we get the dream of humankind, long life, fountain of youth. What's in trouble? How about pension plans, public pension plans particularly? How about health care? And how about relationships? You are going to get married at 22 and stay with this person 118 years? Or worse, get married at 22, divorced at 41, and pay alimony for 99 years? And some of us are in, and many of your clients are in, what is called the sandwich generation. Sandwich between elderly parents and children. But here I am. I'm 120 years old. My 140-year-old parents are living with me. 100-year-old kids just moved back in. So we can have a little fun with it, but let's not miss the serious point. If that wonderful change were to happen, enormously difficult issues wouldn't just be on the table, they would be smack in our face. Real change.
I got to tell my viewers about that clip because that's how I met Mr. Parisse many, many years ago. In fact, it's probably 1990, 91, something like that. And what really was the memorable part of that clip is what you did with the glass draining box there. It almost looks like a crate. And when it was such a great effect, because so many speakers come out and go, "Good morning, everyone. Let's go on with the presentation." But you grabbed their attention right away with that device, and you made fun of yourself in a way because of your height, and you really captured your audience. And I remember that forever.
Yeah, it's interesting because that is what people remember. You work so hard on what you're going to say and how you're going to say it. And what I remember, you stood on the box. And it's a dishwasher rack that they wash dishes in glasses in a commercial dishwasher. Started as an accident, and I'll spare you the story, a long time ago. It worked. But one of the downsides of that was as I was coaching people, up until maybe 6-7 years ago, I never realized how important openings were because I had a good one. And then all of a sudden, because I'd have the audience's attention. Not only did I have it, but I not only was it self-deprecating and I had their attention, but if you really analyze it, and I did because it worked so well for so many years and talked to people about it, that it does something else. You hear a nice introduction and here's this guy and he's blah, blah, blah and all this stuff, and you walk out and I'm short. And the audience is thinking, he's short. And by putting that down, it establishes a dialogue at a very subtle level. It's saying, yeah, I know, I'm short. And it gets a laugh, and it's all gone. And you're there, and you get a beginning. But openings are huge, and now I've come to realize just how important they are. And what you started to say was, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's great to be here in Des Moines. The normal way people start. You got to start. You got to do something at the beginning, boom, get their attention.
Well, excellent. And that stayed with me for years, and I've now taken that concept of figuring out a way to use something physical to capture your audience, and I learned so much from you, Mr. Parisse. So, all right, you mentioned before that you also do speaker coaching. You have a program called the Speaking Intensive Program, and when we come back from the break, I'm going to ask you about it, and then we'll offer tips as well. Okay?
Great.
Too many speakers think they can do it on their own and then fail, but many professional speakers highly recommend working with coaches and mentors. So coming up after the break, I'm going to ask Mr. Parisse about this and get his take on hiring a speaking coach, using mentors, and other tips that he has to offer. Don't go away. We'll be right back.